Welcome back, everyone, to Open Line. Glad you were with us. We are talking about what's happening right now in the special session in the Tennessee General Assembly. One of the major issues is liability protections for businesses. We have with us as our guest Bradley Jackson. He is the CEO of the Tennessee Chamber of Commerce and Industry and strongly supports the idea of passing liability protections for businesses. There are others who have concerns about it, as we kind of outlined in the first part of the program. And now we'll turn over. There is Bradley Jackson on Zoom. We'll take some calls here. Let's go to Jamal. Hello, Jamal.
Good evening, Ben. Good evening, Mr. Jackson. I was watching your show, and I just want to say I've been an essential worker since the beginning of the pandemic. And my company's great. They've done all the PPEs. They give us masks. You know, we clean the buildings four or five times a day. But the reality of it is the public itself. We have people that come into the business, and when we address them about the mask, they say, hey, and we have curbside service, so you don't even have to come in to the store. So I've been quarantined twice, but the thing about it is, they threaten us. We just had someone spit at our whole staff and threaten to be waiting outside to, you know, do physically harm against us. And my thing to you, Mr. Jackson, is you sit on Capitol Hill and y'all have state troopers there protecting y'all. And instead of this legislation, you need to figure out a legislation on passing out some authority to security companies or whatever to be able to go around and work for some of these smaller businesses or mid-range business to be able to write citations. And the police came an hour later, but that's not going to protect the workers or the company at that moment. See, we keep trying to look on the big side of lawsuits. Let's look at the immediate situation of stopping those explosions.
Well, Jamal, thank you for calling. That infuriates me that you're out there, an essential worker. You're probably just asking somebody to put on a mask, and then they flip out over it and would do something like spit or yell even, or even get upset. And it just infuriates me that that's the case. And I'm sorry you have to go through that. What kind of business generally,
it's
if you don't want
to... It's a retail business.
And you were out there, what did you say? Did you say put on a mask or something? And that's when
I didn't even see it. I was in the office, and I heard the commotion came outside, and the guy was arguing, and I was like, sir, I can come outside and do curbside service for you. You do not even have to come in. You know, and I'm not going to wear a mask. I'm not asking you to wear a mask. I'm asking you to give you service outside. We can do everything for you. But it's some people's idea that this is not real, being this pandemic is not a real issue, and they're walking around and they truly believe that they can do whatever they want to, because there's no law out here. Like you said, citations just to start being given out. But when are you going to start to arrest people and prove to them that, yeah, you might not care about, I don't care about infringing on the business life, but it's my life that I care about. That's why I wear a mask.
Right.
I'm worried about the other people. I'm not worried about me.
Well, Jamal, all right, thank you. Let's talk about that. So here we have Bradley Jackson, Jamal, saying his employer is doing everything he feels like the employer can do, but now he's worried about the general public and would like to see some strict enforcement for people that just act the way he describes someone acting. But what are your thoughts on his call there?
Now, Jamal, thank you for that, because we have heard about that, and you bring up a really important issue. You know, we saw where the hiring of private security companies is up, I think it's 30-some-odd%. You know, most of those likely are at larger employers, but small businesses, they need help too. The feedback we get is they don't want, and they don't like putting their employees in the position of having to enforce a mask policy. So it becomes very difficult, you know, when someone outright, you know, gets belligerent about being asked to wear a mask. And it's, you know, a lot of times it's kind of, we wish people would not behave like that. But I think that's a really good point to consider. You know, the enforcement issue is a big question in a lot of communities. You know, Tennessee statute really does not address who has the ultimate authority during, you know, a state of emergency or a pandemic to go out and enforce, you know, face masks. You know, we've seen some areas do it through their local health departments, who are not, you know, they don't have the staff or personnel to be able to go out and do it. You know, and then the next resort is, you know, law enforcement. But, you know, law enforcement has a number of other jobs that they're having to go out there and do. So I think it's tied to a number of things, you know, a lot more data for people to look that this disease is it's a serious disease when you really look at the numbers and how people are impacted about it, and just a little bit of wearing a mask. You know, the gentleman that probably did that and left, I'm sure he had no problem with putting his seatbelt right on and driving away. You know, so there's public safety issues that people really should be considerate about.
So if there isn't, you know, if health departments can't enforce it or police can't enforce it, it means it's just basically not being enforced. And here we are having a special session. Is that something that we need to be looking at? So we're obviously looking at this thing with liability protections for businesses. Should we be looking at some way to better enforce some of these things so that you don't have your essential frontline workers being submitted to this?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very important discussion. I will tell you, we've looked at other states of where they did issue state mask mandates, and then they had locals that either disagreed or conflicted with that. You know, what data really shows is that most people, you know, as case counts start to drastically increase, that's really the number one determinant whether they go out and spend money or, you know, their activity. So when everybody, you know, does work together to wear masks, you know, I don't envision this legislature, and there's not many across who have issued mask mandates, but even if you do, Ben, I mean, you bring up a good point. Who is going to enforce it? And is it going to be, you know, tickets? You know, our courts already have a number of things on them. You know, police have a number of other jobs right now. So it's very hard to balance that, being able to adequately enforce it for local governments, I think.
All right, Jamal, I'm sorry you have to deal with that, but I know you're not alone, and I'm glad you called in and shared your story. It seems pretty basic that people could wear a mask, not just for their own protection, but for the protection of others, but that is not the case. Let's go to Teresa. Hello, Teresa.
Yes.
Go right ahead.
Okay. I really didn't have a question as much as a comment. And my comment was, I do agree with having liability protection for businesses. I'm a small business. I don't want to say what industry I'm in or anything like that. But I do agree that it would help for more people to be able to just come into businesses and the owners not feel like they're going to be sued frivolously by customers, not even just their employees, which usually have health insurance through the employer, but customers don't, and people can use it as an opportunity to try to get rich quick. That's my biggest concern, because we have a lot of it already. And as far as mask mandates, I don't think that's good, because you violate other people's civil liberties by doing that. And, you know, mask is not constitution. It's not a law, it's not a federal law or a state law. So there's a fine line between mandating. I think you could suggest it, but you can't force people to do it, because we have pros and cons on both sides of the mask wearing. That, you know, doctors say that it's, you know, it's harmful. It's re-breathing in your, you know, carbon dioxide every day, and dentists saying it's messing up people's teeth and gums. So, you know, that's a whole nother thing in itself. I think we should stay with the liability of business owners. And no, I think that they should not be liable, because people get sick anywhere. That the flu, you can't pin down what child gave you the flu during flu season at school, and it would be stupid if you did try to sue a parent because you have a flu. You don't know if Johnny did it, Susie, or Karen, so it's irrelevant. It's just life. We can't insulate everything of life. You know, we can do our best, but we're going to have something else after COVID, you know, 5 years down the line. So it's just real life. We have to just deal with life, and life is, we keep moving, keep going on. Take your vitamins, you know, take the medications out there that's for it, and you keep moving. Pray and keep
all right.
moving.
Pray and keep moving. I've not heard that a mask messes up your teeth, but that, I don't want to get sidetracked on all that. Go ahead with whatever you want to comment on what Teresa had to say.
No, I appreciate hearing from a small business owner about liability protections, because, you know, those thoughts go through her head about liability that you have for all these events that could happen, or people out there just trying to prey on the situation. There's so many, you know, small businesses, and now we're seeing it really start to bleed into medium-sized businesses that are really having a difficult time and starting to think through how they're going to get through this pandemic. The one thing that we do know is that, you know, as cases of corona, you know, as they rise and fall, but when they are mitigated, that increases economic activity. The Federal Reserve released a report the other day that they really did say that it doesn't really matter whether states issue emergency orders or local government. People watch numbers of the virus, and when they increase, they drastically change their behavior. They change their buying patterns. You know, today Tennessee had 1,000 cases that was new, and that's one of the lower numbers that we've seen in a number of weeks. And that has been a trend that's starting to slow down a little bit. You know, who knows why, but overall, you know, I would guarantee you that, you know, it tracks directly with people's confidence in them going out and everything. And, you know, this being an airborne disease, it's very difficult to identify the place and time that, you know, that someone contracted it.
All right, we have to take a break. Mark, George, others, hold on the line. If you want to call in, there's the number, 615-737-PLUS, 615-737-7587. We will take a break. Be back right after this.